Words about acquired myasthenia. As you know, acquired myasthenia is immune-mediated disorder which caused by antibodies directed against of this neuromuscular junction proteins. And neuromuscular junction, this is just a connection of synapse between nerve and muscle. And most prevalent cause of is production of acetylcholine receptor antibodies. And the key defect is decrease of number of available acetylcholine receptors in the muscle membrane. As a result, there is decrease in efficiency of this neuromuscular junction that leads eventually to muscle weakness. So this is just kind of quick overview before we dive into the treatment options. So there are, you can look at the options and treatment approaches kind of in three big categories. One is medication that improve neuromuscular transmission or symptomatic management. Second big kind of approach is using immunomodulating therapy medications interfering with antibody activity on this neuromuscular junction, a therapy modulating the circulating antibody with IVIG in plasma exchange. And the third approach is modification of natural history of the disease like thymectomy. So we kind of concentrate today more in this first two big groups. So in 2013, Myasthenia Gravis Foundation America appointed a task force to develop treatment guidelines for myasthenia gravis. And a lot of information that I will present today is actually based on this published guidelines and management. Also, this guidelines develop definitions and goals of therapy. And of course, the goal is therapy to be completely healed and to be in full remission. And the most of our patients, some patients do get a full recovery and remission, and some patients for sure get better. So they all actually determine one of the description of minimal manifestation status. And MMS and better is considered the gold therapy. And minimal manifestation status, when patient has no symptoms, or no functional limitations from myasthenia gravis, but may have some weakness on muscle exam as well. So what, let's talk about symptomatic management. So from symptomatic standpoint, we use the most commonly used medication, and you're probably all familiar with that, is pyridostigmin. And it's part of initial treatment pretty much in most of myasthenic patients. This medication really doesn't treat underlying immune system, but what it does, it's a work on this enzyme acetylcholine esterase that prevent a breakage acetylcholine, and you have more available acetylcholine connected to receptor. By that mechanism, you have more neuromuscular junction works better. There is more muscle strength, and the doses kind of depends on the symptoms and degree of symptoms. So dose varies from like 60 or 120 milligram 3 to 5 times a day, but it's important to remember that usually we not go beyond 480 milligram per day. It's pretty quick onset of action, around like 5 to 30 minutes, but it doesn't stay in your system for a long time, maybe under 8 hours overall. And when we're able to discontinue mestinon or pyridostigmin, it's usually great news because it's an indicator that the disease pretty much in good control. So there are some side effects. And I would say the most side effect that we hear from patients is actually gastrointestinal complaints, like stomach cramping, diarrhea, could be nausea, vomiting. There's medication that that prevent those side effects and help actually us to increase the dosage of mestinon is hyoscyamine or glycopyrrolate, propantiolene, typically Levbit or hyoscyamine commonly used. So other potential side effects is muscle twitching is in cramps. So other complaints I hear about sweating and extra salivation, blurred vision. We have to be careful if somebody has like reduced heart rate because it can also cause bradycardia. So we use this medication, but there's no really randomized controlled trials. As a lot of other medication, we don't have that. So the corticosteroid treatment in myasthenia, so steroids is another group of medications, and prednisone most commonly used. And again, we don't have randomized control trials for that, but it's most effective oral immunotherapy available. The dosage, it depends if there is a more severe case and a patient in hospital setting, we start with larger dosage, like 1 mg/kg, which is somewhere around like 50 to 80 milligrams per day. And in outpatient setting or mild myasthenia gravis, ocular myasthenia, we typically start with smaller dosage, like 10, 20 milligrams per day, and we slowly increase like 5, 10 milligrams every 5-7 days until symptoms control. And why we don't like to start in the large dosage on outpatient setting, because that potential early deterioration, which reported around 20 to 48% cases, and 8% cases, it can be severe. So myasthenia can get worse if you start on large dosage of steroids. So after the treatment on steroids, when you reach maximum response and symptoms kind of plateau, we try to taper those slowly to lowest effective dose and to minimize potential side effects. And I know sometimes it feels like, you know, there's no light in the end of the tunnel, and sometimes we increase steroid doses and we try to taper it down, and this process may take time. And so what I want to point it out that there are reports that alternating day dosing have less side effect profile, and also that in a low dose prednisone, like under 7.5 milligram per day, associated with better tolerability. So we're always concerned about potential side effects, and the list is pretty large. The things that we're concerned about is elevation blood pressure, diabetes, weight gain, reduced bone masses, osteoporosis, as well as glaucoma and cataract development, ulcers, avascular necrosis. There's some issues like with mood irritability. Sometimes I hear from patients, especially husband said, please don't put my wife on this medication. It changed mood and sleep disruption. So what we really want to do, we want to prevent those potential side effects, and we want to be proactive. So what we could do, we recommend frequent blood checks, also monitoring for steroid-induced diabetes, like check hemoglobin A1C a couple few months, especially if large dosage of prednisone administered, low salt, of course, and low carb diet is recommended, at least once per year. Eye exam is helpful to look for that glaucoma and cataract development. Bone density test monitoring maybe once a year just to see there's no any findings of osteopenia, osteoporosis. We do recommend weight-bearing exercise, taking calcium and vitamin D as for preventive purpose osteoporosis. Most of our patients on the calcium, like 1,000 milligram, 800 units of vitamin D. Bisphosphonates, this is a group of medication that you use for osteoporosis. The American College of Rheumatology, they're very proactive with that. I'm not sure we neurologists as much, but their recommendation actually, if somebody like on 5 milligram, above 5 milligram prednisone for more than 3 months, they recommend starting this Fosamax or Alendronate. So, I will talk next about the big group of non-steroidal immunosuppressive agents. Randomized controlled trials, unfortunately, there's a limited efficacy what we use overall. And this immunosuppressive agents, they used alone when there's steroids, prednisone contraindicated or refused, or typically prescribed in conjunction with prednisone. and frequently added to prednisone, especially when prednisone steroid side effects develop or response inadequate to steroids, or we try to taper steroids and we're not able to be on the low dosage. So from these groups, this is like 7 medications that commonly on the market, and I will go over a few of them in detail, some of them just briefly. So most commonly prescribed medication in nowadays is Imuran or azathioprine. And is expert consensus in some randomized control trial shows some evidence and support the use of this medication as a first-line therapy for immunosuppression. So it is prevent T B cell proliferation, and in initial improvement may be experienced around 2 to 10 months, but really the full effect actually requiring almost 1 to 2 years. So it is long wait time on this one. We start around 50 milligrams per day, 100 milligrams per day, and weekly increasing the dosage with the treatment goal somewhere between 2 to 3 milligrams per kilogram. The side effects, of course there are side effects we have to talk about, and I would say 10% of our patient complains on flu-like symptoms and could be pretty disabling and annoying. Other things that we are concerned about: reduce white blood cell count and anemia, red blood cell count, liver toxicity, abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting can be seen, skin rash. So we have to monitor, and we typically do blood counts, so like CBC, we check liver function test 1 to 4 times in the first months, and then it's spaced to 1 to 3 months, every 1 to 3 months. And there's so some questions about, some patient raised question about, should we test for this TPM? This is an enzyme deficiency that could potentially lead to bone marrow toxicity. So, I mean, some clinicians do check this enzyme, but really in the true deficiency in the general population is 0.3%. So you can test for this deficiency, or you can just do regular blood test and see if there is any development, leukopenia, anemia, and you can reduce the medication or stop. So another medication that commonly used and widely used is CellCept. However, the available randomized control trial evidence does not support use, and there's a debate why it is, and possibly because the trial was just too short. So the study dose is around 500 milligram twice a day, and the maximum dose around 2,000 to 3,000 milligram per day. It has a benefit in terms of, in comparison with azathioprine, because it start to work faster, around onset of benefit around maybe 2 to 5 months, but again, substantial effect, you have to wait to around 9 to 12 months. Side effect profile may a little bit lighter. You don't have a lot of, in terms of liver side effects and liver toxicity, but we do see some reduced white blood cell count, sometimes anemia, gastrointestinal symptoms with some abdominal pain and nausea. So we do recommend monitoring blood counts and every 4 weeks initially, once per week in the first few weeks, so every 2 weeks when we increase in the dosage, and then once every every 3 months, something like that. So another medication is cyclosporine, and there are some evidence that from randomized control trials that support use this medication, but there are potential serious side effects. So we don't use this medication very often, and there is also potential drug interactions with this medication. And starting dose around 100 milligram twice a day, and can be titrated to 3 to 6 milligram per day on twice a day schedule. It takes 1 to 3 months to start work, and minimum improvement in 6 months. What's difficult with this medication, you really have to monitor the blood level. And if side effects profile very concerning to us, nephrotoxicity, kidney toxicity, liver toxicity. Patient complain on a lot of tremor, headache, nausea. There is posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome can develop, gum hyperplasia. So, and from monitoring standpoint, CBC, liver function test, kidney function has to be monitored pretty closely. Again, not commonly used. So another medication is methotrexate. You probably heard about this one. And again, randomized controlled trial was negative, but it is used in community as well, not the first line, but probably second, third, I would say. So the starting dose around 10 milligrams, and we increase dosage slowly to reach around 15 to 25 milligrams per week. This is very easy to take medication once per week dosage. Onset action, not too long, 2 to 6 months. Potential side effects, of course there are side effects. We have to watch for interstitial lung disease that is kind of unique for this medication. And we have periodically monitor with breathing parameters for this condition. The other issues could occur, like reduced white blood cell count, patient complain nausea, diarrhea, headaches, hair loss. Nephrotoxicity is pretty rare. Another medication I want to use, show here, is tacrolimus. It's alternative choice for more severe and myasthenia gravis. It's pretty commonly used in Japan. We don't, again, use as often in States. And this medication also, we need to monitor the trough or level of medication in your blood. It takes 1 to 3 months for onset of action, and concerning side effects is development diabetes and elevation of blood sugar, again, also some high blood pressure, headache, elevation potassium level in the blood, kidney toxicity, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting. So we recommend monitoring of the kidney function, glucose level, potassium level, and the trough or blood level. On a regular basis. So Cytoxan, another medication that again reported to be effective in treatment myasthenia gravis, but limited usage during potential side effects. We use a lot of this medication for like vasculitis, peripheral nerve vasculitis, and neuromuscular disorders, but it's on the list of in myasthenia, severe myasthenia. Again, this is not the first line medication, and dosage is based, can be oral as a pill intake or intravenous infusion, and intravenous infusion typically has less potential side effects based on the meter square weight base. Onset action around 2 to 6 months. Potential side effects, nausea and vomiting, I would say more commonly develop, but it can be prevented with usage of some medication, anti-nausea medication before infusion, reduce white blood cell count, hair loss, skin discoloration, hemorrhagic cystitis, that's a big one on potential side effect list. So we have to monitor not only blood count, kidney function, electrolytes, but also to check urine analysis every 2 to 4 weeks when patient on this medication. So rituximab. So rituximab should be considered as early therapeutic option for patient with anti-MASC myasthenia gravis. And evidence for other forms of myasthenia is kind of building, but we don't have a formal consensus. This medication works on works on B cell, CD20, CD19 antigen. And so dosage of this medication variable, but what's commonly used, I would say 375 milligram per meter square, administered once per week for 4 weeks, and next cycle can be repeated in 6 months or later. Rheumatology colleagues, they very like this formulation when they give pretty much 1,000 big dosage every 2 weeks, times two dosage, and they kind of stop on that. So there's different way to give this medication. Maximum response around 3 to 4 months, but what's beautiful about this, and I personally favor this medication a lot for my myasthenia mask patient, because some effect can last like from 6 months to up to even 5 years. I mean, I haven't seen 5 years, but I have patients who have been asymptomatic for 2 years. So side effects. Infusion reaction, especially patient complaining nausea and fever and hypertension. PML, which is like infection, JC virus, infection of the brain, is theoretical complication. However, risk is pretty much low. And there's no published data on that, but we always tell patient about this potential risk factor. So, what's the duration of all this immunosuppressive therapies that I just described to you? So, we maintain this medication for years. The goal would be to taper these medications, and we try to taper it pretty slowly, maybe every 3 to 6 months. There is a risk, of course, a relapse of myasthenia when we do that. So usually we maintain this medication for a few years, or even many years. So one slide for myasthenia gravis with mask antibodies to highlight a few things of treatment here. We know that patients with mask antibodies have a more poor response to pyridostigmine in comparison as patients with other antibody or antibody negative. And even typical dosage of mestinon can produce some fasciculation, significant fasciculation, so patients have to stop the medication. Mask myasthenia patients respond pretty well to steroids overall. And I mentioned about rituximab should be considered as early therapeutic option for mask myasthenia. When there is a crisis or myasthenia gravis exacerbation, plasma exchange works, we know, much better than immune IVIG typically. So, and I have one more quote. I know, sorry, that's probably small slide here, but I want to, yeah. So, yes, but I'll tell you what is there. So, with just a slide about ocular myasthenia. So, the definition of ocular myasthenia from this international guidance, guide consensus, is that the patient with ocular myasthenia have only ocular muscle weakness, and there is no any other muscle weakness, but the fatigue can be seen as well. So, what the treatment? It kind of depends what the symptoms are. If there are non-medical treatment, when there is symptoms of ptosis, so the eyelid drooping, and there is no double vision. Sometimes people use patch or eyelid taping. I give patients sometimes prescription for this eyelid crutches. I mean, I know young women would not be happy with that, but some more elder gentlemen who wear glasses may be happy with this solution and don't want to take any other medication that has like little wire that holds your eyelid. For patient who has double vision, that would not help, of course, because it would not correct double vision in any way. So pyridostigmine could be used alone or together with prednisone. So prednisone, usually the dosage for ocular myasthenia is much smaller, around 20, 30 milligrams. We probably can reach pretty good control of ocular myasthenia. And currently there is no sufficient evidence from randomized controlled trial that high use steroids therapy can delay disease progression to generalize. Some steroid-sparing agents that I described can be also prescribed, like Imuran or Celcept. Timectomy is only for patient who has timoma. I mean, most patients with timoma would have more generalized myasthenia than ocular. I want to mention strabismus surgery here. In our friends of neuro-ophthalmology, they report that if somebody has pretty stable ocular measurement at 6 months, patient can be considered for strabismus surgery. I don't know, we neuromuscular world, we're probably a little bit more conservative about that because the prognosis is kind of variable, but my personal opinion probably would go 12 months and assuming there's no change in eye misalignment after 12 months, you know, the strabismus surgery can be considered. So this is what I have, and thank you very much for your attention. I think we'll take the questions in the end, and I'll let Dr. Zinsky present.
So plasmapheresis, or also therapeutic plasma exchange, so that's where the PLEX comes from, plasma exchange, or TPE. And what that procedure is there's separation of blood and exchanging the plasma, which has normal and pathogenic immunoglobulins, with donor plasma or albumin and returning the red cells back to the patient. So what this does is it accomplishes removal of humoral factors, so things like the autoantibodies that are causing the MG, immune complexes, complement, and other nonspecific inflammatory mediators. And so as many of you know, this takes 3 to 6 liters of plasma over several hours for the procedure. So why does that work? So MG, it's considered a model of IgG-mediated autoimmunity. So what we found in doing some studies is that total antibodies in patients with MG, they drop after the therapeutic plasma exchange. So the plasma exchange removes subclasses of immunoglobulin. And so the IgG is what the antibody we think it's bound to because the antibody levels are low after plasma exchange and so are immunoglobulin levels. So the IgG reconstitutes after about 3 weeks, all of them except for IgG3, and the other IgM, IgA, they reconstitute after about a week. And this was some studies that were done. So the ACHR antibody is predominantly IgG1 bound and MuSK is IgG4 bound. So by doing this procedure and getting rid of the IgG, you get rid of the antibodies and therefore there's improvement in symptoms. But because of the reconstitution of IgG, the antibody is reconstituted and the symptoms can come back. So this is actually really important when we discuss the FcRn therapies, which is what Dr. Pulley and his colleague were talking about yesterday. So this is why plasma exchange works. So in summary, it effectively eliminates IgG subclasses, MGG-associated autoantibodies are IgG-bound, and by eliminating IgG, you thereby eliminate the antibody, but the effect is not sustained because as these IgGs reconstitute, symptoms come back because the antibodies are there. So intravenous immunoglobulin, which we call IVIG, so this is a blood product, and it's from human plasma pooled from many donors. It's purified. There are viral inactivation methods, and it's also stabilized to avoid it from to avoid clotting. And it's more than 90% of it is IgG, and less than 2.5 is IgA. And certain formulations may have more or less IgA. The half-life is 18 to 32 days, and the way that it works is a couple of different things. So we think there is some anti-inflammatory benefits. There's balance of cytokines, shifts towards an anti-inflammatory state, counteracts some of the B cells, interrupts several steps in complement activation, down-regulates macrophages. So the way that IVIG is dosed is 2 grams per kilogram over 4 to 5 days as a loading dose, and then the maintenance dose is 1 to 2 grams per kilogram every 3 to 4 weeks on average, but sometimes it's more frequent than that, or less frequent. There's currently no FDA indication for IVIG use in myasthenia gravis, so this is sometimes the reason why people can have insurance coverage issues with IVIG, because there's no FDA indication. There were some papers that were published and some studies that were done in 2007 that show there's a benefit of IVIG as compared to placebo 14 days after treatment, and they also noted that the response was maintained for 28 days after infusion. So what they concluded at the time is that this is fairly rapid improvement because, as you saw in the previous slides, the azathioprine and the mycophenolate take months to become effective, whereas the IVIG is much more rapid to help improve the symptoms. They also demonstrated in the study that patients who had moderate to severe disease had statistically significant improvement, whereas those who had mild symptoms or purely ocular symptoms did not have as much improvement. So going back to this international consensus statement, so this is at this time the only set of guidelines that we have that are published for the different therapies that are out there. So what the guidelines say is that plasma exchange and IVIG are appropriate to use as short-term treatments in patients who have life-threatening signs such as respiratory insufficiency, so this is in crisis, and the choice between plasma exchange or IVIG for crisis depends on several things, like availability of these treatments at wherever institution the patient may be at, and also if there's some condition they may have that's contraindicated, then you would pick one over the other. And they are probably equally effective in the treatment of severe generalized MG, except for in the case of MuSK-MG, it tends to be more responsive to plasma exchange. The efficacy of IVIG is less certain in milder MG or in ocular MG. And again, as I just mentioned, that the plasma exchange may be more effective than IVIG and MuSK. The use of IVIG as maintenance therapy can be considered for patients with refractory MG or for those in whom immunosuppressive agents are relatively contraindicated. Because we have this in the guidelines, I can use this sometimes to justify if an insurer says, we will not cover this treatment. I say, well, we have a set of guidelines that says in those where they have refractory symptoms or the immunosuppressive agents are not as effective or perhaps they're contraindicated, this may be justification to use IVIG or plasma exchange using these guidelines that we have. So eculizumab or Soliris, so this is the new medication, and this was discussed yesterday, it's a complement, a terminal complement inhibitor, and it was just FDA approved a little bit over a year ago in October of 2017. So we think that one of the modes of autoimmunity with AChR myasthenia is complement-mediated attack of the receptors. This is not true of MuSK. We do not think that complement is involved in MuSK. In the clinical trial for eculizumab, this was studied in patients who had severe symptoms or moderate to severe symptoms. The MG-ADL, which is an outcome measures, had to have a score of greater than 6. The MGFA class had to be 2 to 4. So these patients they did not have pure ocular myasthenia, and they were not patients in crisis. They were somewhere in between, and they had also previous treatments of at least 2 immunosuppressive therapies or 1 immunosuppressive therapy, and they were on chronic IVIG or plasma exchange for 12 months. Prior to be eligible for this study. So this is the patient population that was in the trial. The other important thing is that terminal complement inhibition makes the patient complement deficient, and so this predisposes them to meningococcal infections. They need to be vaccinated against the meningococcal infection. And if it needs to be done at least 2 weeks prior to initiation of therapy, or they can be on antibiotics in that time if needed. This is an IV drug. It is given as a loading dose for 5 weeks. There's a weekly infusion of 900 milligrams IV for 4 weeks, then 1,200 milligrams on week 5, and then 1,200 milligrams every 2 weeks thereafter. And if somebody is also on plasma exchange, they need to have a supplemental dose within 6 hours of the plasma exchange. So I'll also mention juvenile MG and MG in pregnancy, because what we wanted to do is go over the treatments that were discussed in this international consensus statement guidelines from 2016. So in juvenile myasthenia gravis, acetylcholinesterase inhibitors can be used, so that is pyridostigmine, and it's dosed based on weight. And older children can be on adult doses of the pyridostigmine. 35% of prepubertal children achieve remission without thymectomy, but role of thymectomy in prepubertal children is poorly defined, and sometimes it is considered when medical treatment proves to be unsatisfactory. This is just a list of all the medications and doses that can be used in myasthenia. Obviously, we do not like to give young children some of these medicines, but they may need it. So pyridostigmine would be the first line, prednisone. There's also some other things on this list like cyclosporin and azathioprine, and lower on the list is the mycophenolate. So this is from that consensus statement. Children with acquired autoimmune ocular MG are more likely than adults to go into spontaneous remission. So young children with only ocular symptoms can be treated with pyridostigmine immunotherapy, can be initiated if goals of therapy are not met. And children are at particular risk of steroid side effects because it can stunt their growth, poor bone mineralization, so they can develop brittle bones and osteoporosis, susceptibility to infection, they have long life expectancy, so we would not like to immunosuppress them for many, many years. And so we want them to be on the lowest effective dose of corticosteroid or whatever else they're on. Maintenance plasma exchange or IVIG are also alternatives to immunosuppressant drugs in juvenile myasthenia. Myasthenia gravis in pregnancy, there are some of the medications on the list that are contraindicated. Methotrexate and mycophenolate are contraindicated, and methotrexate should be discontinued 3 months before considering conception, and mycophenolate 6 months before considering conception. Azathioprine and corticosteroids can be continued. They do not seem to affect fertility. Women who are treated with rituximab are advised to use contraception 12 months after the last treatment. And effects of rituximab beyond 12 months are not well known. And if a patient is planning to become pregnant, thymectomy should be considered, but if they're already pregnant, then not, because the effects of thymectomy are long-term and they're not expected to see these benefits during pregnancy, and you're subjecting them, obviously, to a very major procedure, surgery. And those who have had thymectomy are thought to have lower likelihood of the baby having neonatal MG, which is a transient myasthenic syndrome that improves, and it's a result of maternal antibodies being transmitted to the baby. A plasma exchange can be used in crisis, although it can remove some of the hormones that are important to maintain the fetus and may induce premature delivery because of the hormone shifts. There's also removal of coagulant factors. And so I know the OBGYN physicians get really worried about this in case there needs to be cesarean delivery. So those are things to consider. IVIG safety has not been established in MG and pregnancy itself, but has been documented in a multitude of neurologic disorders. There is potential risk of hyperviscosity and volume overload, but generally it can be used safely in pregnancy. So treatments of choice, pyridostigmine and corticosteroids. Not recommended to start immunosuppressant agents because of their delayed effects and will not benefit pregnancy during disease anyway, and a lot of those are cannot be used anyway except for the azathioprine and the other ones on the list coming up in the next slide. With steroids, there is slightly higher risk of cleft palate, premature rupture of membranes, and gestational diabetes. For pyridostigmine, it's recommended to use a dose less than 600 milligrams per day. An IV should be avoided because it can cause uterine contractions. So I have a list here of the different things for pregnancy. So prior to conception, you have pyridostigmine, corticosteroids, who do not have any concerns, and during pregnancy they can be used. IVIG as well, and then the other medications, azathioprine is thought to be the commonly used medication that's on the list that can be used in pregnancy. So the consensus guidance, these are going to be very busy slides. They have a lot of information, but it summarizes pretty much everything that I said here. The other thing they do comment on is scanning, so chest CT, if this is a newly diagnosed woman who is pregnant, thymectomy will not change her disease state in the immediate 9 months anyway, so they recommend deciding whether or not to actually have the CT scan of the chest, because it is a lot of radiation to the baby, so the risks and benefits need to be considered. So there's some more slides on that as well. So for the eculizumab pregnancy data, so we do not have that available for myasthenia gravis, but they had done, it's called a pharmacovigilance study, so they look at data from 10 years for patients who have paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria and atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome, which is, these are diseases that the eculizumab has been used for over the past 10 years, and they found that exposure was reported in 434 women, and there were 72% live births in the PNH and 59% in HUS, and there were induced abortion in 8% of PNH and 20% of HUS. They reported one serious case of infection in the newborn, but they didn't think that it was attributed to the drug exposure. So for pregnancy, that's the only data available that we have. And as we use the drug more in complement inhibition in years to come, we should have data on pregnancy and MG.